today, the last speaker, maybe I should introduce myself first, because I studied philosophy in bachelor and master degree, and then my PhD I studied musicology in Berlin. And then, but now I'm professor in philosophy in ABEC. And then, for me, music and philosophy, I think they cannot be separated.
Yeah, they're very related.
Yes, and I found that Confucius had some opinions very similar to me. My opinions are very similar to him. Okay, then that's what I want to introduce you today. Okay, then the topic is 雅乐 and the spirit of humanity. Okay, and 雅乐 was originally a form of classic music and dance performed at the royal court in ancient China, which received its basic conventions in the Western Zhou dynasty. Okay, and the literal translation of 雅乐 is elegant music or proper music, which was differentiated from 俗乐, that means common music or vernacular music. And you can see this picture that is in over 2,500 years before in China already. The music instruments already many different kinds. Okay, and 雅乐, okay, this term received its philosophical and moral significance by Confucius, the most important philosopher in China. Actually, Confucius was not only a philosopher or politician, but also an excellent musician and musicologist. He gave 雅乐 its determination according to his philosophical understanding and, more importantly, his musical experience. For Confucius, the spirit of humanity is the highest criteria of his philosophy and of 雅乐. This insight influenced the whole following development of intellectual field and music in the Chinese history. Okay, then today the presentation has five parts. Okay, the first one is about the historical background. If you ever learned some Chinese history, you will know that very complicated. there are the so-called three dynasties, Xia, Shang, and Zhou. Okay, and Zhou had two parts, Western Zhou and Eastern Zhou. And in the Eastern Zhou, there are still two parts, Spring and Autumn, and another is Warring States. Okay, why this? Because in the Eastern Zhou, the descendants of Zhou dynasty had their own power and fought each other. Then there were many, many small states at that time. Okay, and Confucius lived in this period. Okay, then an important book, the Analects. Analects was not written by Confucius, but by his disciples. Okay, but in the Analects, there are many different descriptions about Confucius' musical experiences. And there is a description about the musical phenomena at that time. Okay, very chaotic. The cult musicians, okay, they went to other countries because at that time, too chaotic, and the cult, the Zhou cult, cannot serve them. Okay, and then Confucius has the sense of mission that, okay, he must support and conserve this Zhou tradition. And then he said, okay, it was only after I had returned from Wei to Lu, okay, Lu is his original country, okay, that music was rectified with the Ya and the Song, each getting their places. Okay, Ya and Song are two modes of Ya Yue. Okay, then I want to introduce you that actually Confucius is a qualified musician. Okay, the first one is, when the master was in Qi, he heard the shao and for 3 months did not notice the taste of meat. He said, I did not image that music making reached such perfection. Okay, this is a very famous description about Confucius. And we can see that, I think, through the Western history of music, no one has such an experience, only Confucius. Okay, then according to my interpretation, okay, actually Confucius had a very specific sensibility of music, not normal people. And then he can always, in the 3 months, always enjoy it in the music. Okay, then second, he always devoted himself to music. When the master was in company with a person who was singing, if he sang well, he would make him repeat the song while he accompanied it with his own voice. Okay, and another description, in late spring, when the spring robes have been made with 5 or 6 capped youths and 6 or 7 uncapped boys, I would bathe in the Yi, a river, feel the breeze and the dancing sacrifice and return home, chanting, always enjoy the music. Okay, then the third, he was not only an amateur, he is really an expert. Okay, he even taught the music officer in the court. He taught him that their music, insofar as it may be known about, can be to be in unison when they started to play. Following upon this, it was somewhat harmonious, clear, and unbroken right through until it was finished. Okay, the next, Confucius' idea of music. Here I indicate some points. The first one is the understanding of music. That means he always not only to emphasize the technique, how to perform the music instrument, but he emphasized to understand the meaning of music. There is a very famous description about Confucius. He learned the Guqin, the Chinese instrument. Okay, he learned Qin by Master Shi Xiang. 10 days have passed and he didn't proceed to a new piece. And then the master said, now you can learn something more. And he replied, Qiu is his real name. Qiu has learned the piece but not got the number. Okay, number maybe means rhythm here. Okay, then sometime later, Master Shi Xiang said, you've learned the number and then can proceed. And he replied, Chou hasn't got the intention. Okay, and then after some time, Master said, you've learned the intention and then can proceed. He replied, I haven't got the characters of the composer. Okay, and then later, after a period of time, Confucius, silently, thoughtful, okay, already enlightenment, okay, silently, thoughtful, gracefully, seeing high and far, with profound intention, said, okay, Chou has got the characters of the composer. He had black skin and a long figure. He so far, just like governed four kingdoms. If it was not King Wen, okay, King Wen is a very, the ancient king in China before Confucius, who could be the composer? And then his teacher said, wow, very good. He left the woman, met and paid respect twice to Confucius and said, my teacher said, this piece is just called the Chant of King Wen. Okay. And then, that means, okay, he set a very high standard, even higher than his teacher, Shi Xiang, for the understanding of music, which has four stages. To know the piece, to know the number, to know the intention, and to know the characters of the composer. Okay. And then, besides, the four stages must be achieved step by step. Okay, the next point is the sound of humanity. Okay, this description. Okay, he said that if someone is not human in spirit of being a man, what has he to do with ritual? Okay, if someone is not human in spite of being a man, what has he to do with music? Okay. Here I must add something that actually ritual and music are the two most important things that Confucius always emphasized, because ritual is an outside standard to regulate us, and music is from inside. Okay, but the essence should be the humanity. Okay. Then, further, he set a very famous standard that, okay, then get rid of the sounds of Zheng and banish clever talkers. The sounds of Zheng are licentious, and clever talkers are a menace. Okay, and what does it mean, the licentious? Okay, licentious here means that the music just concentrated on the expression of emotion and sensational stimuli rather than the higher idea of humanity. The music in Zheng state, okay, just enforced the biological characters of human being and cannot elevate the spirituality, and thus should be banished. Okay, and the last part, okay, music and learning to be human. Okay, the first is the embodiment of humanity. Okay, Confucianism is also called the doctrine of humanity because humanity is the core of it. Humanity, however, is not an abstract concept just for discussion, but must be embodied in practice. Okay, then, and then that's why Confucius always emphasized the five ethical relationships in the society. Okay, that means father, son, the king and the general, and brotherhood, and friends, and husband and wife. Okay, they are the five ethical relationships, and people should train themselves in these five ethical relationships. Okay, and here is a citation from a professor in Peking University. Okay, he said that learning to be human then means becoming aesthetically refined, morally excellent, and religious profound. Okay, that means human being is not only a biological concept, but an ethical or metaphysical concept. Okay. Then the Confucian idea of the self as the center of relationships, okay, the so-called five ethical relationships, is an open system. It is only through the continuous opening up of the self to others that the self can maintain a wholesome personal identity. The person who is not sensitive or responsive to the others around him is self-centered. Self-centeredness easily leads to a closed world, or in Songming terminology, to a state of paralysis. Okay, and then music, this thing, or this art, this technique, is very special. Okay, I already mentioned the five ethical relationships, right? And Confucius also emphasized in the ancient China, we have the so-called six arts. Okay, what are they? They are ritual, music, archery, chariot, riding horse, yes, and then calligraphy, and arithmetic. Okay, and these six arts or techniques. Okay, music. Inside, it's not a pure technique training of line, but the training for sensibility and taste. In the six arts, music is the only one which can develop our sensibility and responsivity to the others. Okay, and then the professor in Peking University, okay, he said that in the Confucian tradition, the audio perception is often singled out as particularly significant for the cultivation of sympathy. The art of listening is crucial for self-knowledge. Sound is considered more powerful than sight. Smell, taste, and touch in penetrating into the innermost landscape of our heart and mind. The virtue of the ear is receptivity. Our ability to feel a sympathetic resonance with the world around us through sound is worth cultivating because it helps us to be in tune with our fellow human beings and with nature. Okay, Confucius remarked that his ear became shun, okay, the ancient Chinese means compliant, obedient, or attuned. Okay, at the age of 60, okay, already old. And this connotes a profound care, a desire to listen non-judgmentally and receptively to all the sounds in the spirit of impartiality. Okay, and then the next point, roused by poetry, established by leisure, and perfected by music. Okay, this is Confucius. Confucius, his own dictum. Okay, and why these three things? At the initial phase of self-cultivation, most people need to be stimulated, and poetry is the best motor for it, because people are not only stimulated, but will have so many advantages. Okay, Confucius said that people can learn many things in poetry. Okay, new terms, new things in the world. Okay, and then afterwards, the outward behaviors are rectified by a ritual, which regulates all the ethical relationships in the society. Okay. And then if therefore people intend to reach the perfection of humanity, then people should strive to refine their innermost landscape of heart and mind through the elegance of music. Okay. Music is the last phrase to promote our humanity. Okay, then the coda, Confucius' opinions of music hugely influenced the Confucian aesthetics of music. It is not only he was the founder of Confucianism, but because he was a real musician and had deep understanding of this art. And the next point, I am very happy to share with you professional musicians that okay, music education nowadays, okay, according to my opinion, stresses more and more in a prejudiced way of technique training and ignores the understanding of music. The musicians are not aware of the differentiation between proper music, which always investigates the higher level of human spirit, and the normal music, which just tries to invoke the biological characters of human beings. And then, okay, the musicians compose and perform music in the improper way. And then some remarks from composer Jiang Wenyi. Okay, he asserted that Confucius was a musician. He was an artist with complete gift for music. And another philosopher, he admired that Confucius might be the most obvious and greatest discoverer of spirit of art in Chinese history. Yes, okay. Then that's all. Mm-hmm. And but if because this is the Institute of Music, and theoretically we should have some music. And then I show you.
Hi everyone, this is
now the Ya Yue,
Taipei, Taiwan.
No, we don't have
now
the curtain, right?
Now I'm standing at the
then,
entrance
the
of
Ya
Yue Taipei Confucius
China or
Temple.
Taiwan just.
This is one of the most popular sites
for
tourists to visit.
Confucius.
Let's go inside. Taipei Kong Miao. The Taipei Confucius Temple was begun in 1879 and re-erected on Da Long Street in 1939. The design of the temple is an example for typical Fujian temple style. This is the main building of Taipei Confucius Temple, called Da Chen Dian. September 28th is Jiao Shi Jie, means Teacher's Day, which is celebrated to commemorate the birth of Confucius, the ultimate sage. On this day, Taipei Confucius Temple would hold a grand and solemn ceremony dedicated to Confucius. Means the ceremony begins. All these musicians, dancers, and deacons advance to the beats of the drum with making five steps and one stop in between beats. Pei Ji Guan, Jiu Wei, means the assistant sacrifice officers take their designated positions. Ying Shen means welcome spirit. This is to reverentially welcome the descent of Confucian spirit. They hold Ti Deng, lanterns, San, umbrella, and Shan, sunshade. Wan Shi Shi Biao on the sunshade means Confucius is the model teacher of ages. Xing Chu Xian Li means initial principal presentation. The ceremony is highlighted by a traditional Ba Yi Wu, means 8-square formation dance, to pay tribute to the Confucian ideologies of teaching without social class discrimination and teaching students in accordance with their aptitude. The Yong Zhong is a large bell set to the east side. The Jing Gu is a large drum set to the west side. The arrangement represents matin bells and vesper drums. The shen is consisting of 13 bamboo pipes inserted in a metal chamber with finger holes. They dance with the ritual objects, di, pheasant tail feather, and yue, ancient short flute. According to the Chinese ancient customs, the pheasant tail feather is the most beautiful thing. Therefore, it is taken for showing the highest respect to Confucius. Teacher's Day is also a day to honor our teachers and acknowledge their hard work over the past years. After visiting the ceremony, I have learned a lot about Confucius and also the Chinese culture. If you come to Taipei, it would be worth your while to have a visit in Taipei Confucius Temple. See you next time.
Okay, thank you very much.
I think we still have a few minutes for exchange idea of even something after what you learned from this.
Yes. You presented to us the philosophy of Confucian. I'm wondering whether is there an aspect of research that you're working on this Confucian music? Is it maybe the application of this music to present students and how it affects them? Is there a research area that you're looking at?
Yes. Now, of course, because at that time there was no recording technique, right? Then we don't know the real music at that time. But because now I teach in the Department of Philosophy, then my point is the philosophical theories about his music aesthetics. But maybe later, for example, in my abstract, this Ya Yue, actually in the Tang Dynasty already spread to Japan, Korea, and Vietnam also. And maybe in the future, for example, this institute invited me to be the teacher. Then I can do something more concrete, really on music and sound. And also its development in the Asian area. Yes, but now I only do the philosophical part.
It made me, your paper make me remind my memory in the aesthetic class. In my college, yeah, but all of the parts in the class are talking about the Western philosophy, and there concepts like this appeared in ancient Greek.
Ancient Greek, yes, especially Plato.
Plato
yes, their opinions were very similar.
Yes, just sharing.
Yes.
Thank you. You might find this question strange, but do you think Confucius danced? Or at least what is his...
Confucius dance?
Do you think, or what is his view of dancing?
I have no idea. But there is a famous movie about him. In the movie, he plays very well.
Right. What comes to mind is this very clear separation between body and mind, and so probably it follows also with the separation of music from dance, and the idea of understanding has to do with thinking and not necessarily embodying or doing. But I'm surprised that in the ritual that you showed, the last part, that there is actually dancing in the ritual. So maybe ritual involves the body. But is that a lower form of?
Yes. If you mean this kind of dance, then I would say that Confucius should be an expert, because he was an expert about the ritual at that time. And he should know every details in the ceremony. Yes, and then of course including the dance. Yes.
Can you see the last slide?
Wondering when you make this differentiate between proper music and vernacular music, does that mean that vernacular music? Well, there's actually two questions here, because I think the term vernacular music doesn't have to be something that is invoking biological, or what is the word, licentious behavior. I mean, vernacular just means of an idiom of the local population. So I think that's maybe the term is not exactly what you're trying to convey. I think you're trying to say that music that elevates, and then there's music that is just very very common, sort of emotional biological
entertainment.
Yeah. But does that mean that the biological entertaining music has no place, that it should be avoided? Or I mean, because the problem with ideology and the problem with philosophy is there are going to be people who take it to the extreme, and you know, they use these things as sort of a way to pressure people to do things certain ways. I mean, it's good when we can sort of, you know, understand that music has a very high deep level, like you said, with teaching in the conservatories, that it's not something that people pay attention to. But I'm concerned that this type of, you know, separation of music into the high and the low or whatever can be taken to a negative extreme.
Yes, of course, in the history of Western music, we also always introduce two parts, right?
Mm-hmm.
The music in the cult and also the normal music, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and it is similar. But I think Confucius's opinion is we should go back to his age.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, at that time. Okay, that's why I introduced you the historical
mm-hmm.
background. Okay, very chaotic,
mm-hmm.
and most people don't think what is humanity. How can to be a better,
mm-hmm.
better man? Okay, and every kingdom they just fought each other,
mm-hmm.
and then that's why he indicated this opinion
mm-hmm.
to elevate our spirituality.
Mm-hmm.
But of course he knew that the normal music cannot be totally moved out. It is impossible. But he just emphasized that okay, the proper music, we should emphasize
mm-hmm.
it more.
Mm-hmm.
And actually in my footnote I found that actually Theodor Adorno. Adorno also, yes, also has the same opinion.
Adorno,
yes.
Is that, I mean, the Nazis called
yeah.
jazz decadent music and forbid it. It was,
mm-hmm.
I mean, the whole type of period. I don't know if the period of Confucius' time with today is so different.
but I think their opinions are similar,
uh-huh.
because. Because we can see that nowadays the musical phenomena actually similar. For example, when normal people mention music this term, their first image is pop music, street music, and very loud and with drugs, right? Okay, and then that's why Adorno also emphasize that we should emphasize how to say that, yes, something similar to this proper
mm-hmm.
music.
A very functional, intellectual, ideological music.
Okay, thank you.
Presentation and for all participants.